Welcome to Diablos in Podcastica with Toomey and Wadzilla.
What is up, everybody? Welcome into another episode of Diablos in Podcastica. As always, I am Joshua Toomey, joined by...
Oh, yeah! Wadzilla, baby. What's up?
What is up, man? How you been?
Oh, I'm not too bad. I'm still recovering from my birthday. my birthday happened since we last recorded, and it was the first time I got, like, literally, like, really drunk in 3 months.
Wow.
I've been like abnormally good during this whole coronavirus situation. That was the first time I was drunk in 3 months. Now I had, you know, drinks, you know, but I'm talking like, you know, Ian drunk. That was the first time I got Ian drunk in 3 months. I started riding a bike. I've been riding about 40 miles a week.
Nice.
And been lifting weights at home.
Man.
And yeah. Yeah, which is so weird and not me. But, you know, it's what I've been doing.
Is this a midlife crisis?
I guess so. I guess I think I'm just trying to get, like, in better shape for when this shit comes back and really kicks our ass again. You know, it's like, I got to get in better shape so I don't die from this fucking shit. But, you know, I mean, any kind of exercise and shit like that's good. And, you know, even I take a break from the drinking every once in a while. But I haven't been in the mood, you know. It's like, you know, with this whole social distancing crap, you know, it's like I'm just having my friends come over and having a drink or something, you know, or you're happy. You know, everybody's so fucking depressed all the time.
Yeah, it's a rough time, man. I'm not a big heavy drinker anyway. Like, I used to obviously drink a lot. And then now, you know, the older I get, the more just like, it's just not appealing to me. It's not something I just search out, you know, like the, during the NFL playoffs, you know, I'll go to the bar and drink and have a good time and all that stuff. But really since the playoffs, I haven't really,
drank playoffs.
Playoffs? Don't talk about playoffs. You kidding me? Playoffs? I just hope we can win a game.
And then we did get some wine one night and we played like board games and we got shit faced and it was awesome. But other than that, man, we haven't really been drinking a lot here.
Can you get drunk on wine? Like Boone's Farm or Bartles and James? What were you drinking?
No, red wine. You know, like we're like Game of Thrones up in this piece.
Oh man, I can't drink wine, man. I don't know. It tastes like fucking like stinky feet. I don't know. I can't do it. I like champagne.
Hmm.
But man, I'll tell you what, I don't know if I want anything after my birthday. Holy bejesus.
What was on the list?
Vodka, man. Fucking vodka.
You doing your best Paul Stanley impression all night?
Yeah, I was drinking vodka and cranberry because I got my period. Woo! You know, but, yeah, man, I was drinking some, you know, trash shit. I have a couple beers the day before my birthday. First time I've had beer in 3 months. I had Rolling Rock. But, yeah, so I got nasty vodka drunk and had about as good a time as you can have spending your birthday alone.
that sounds so sad.
It was like the saddest birthday ever. You know, like I used to throw big bashes and shit like that, and, you know. You know, being single during this thing, and then, you know, all my friends are married and their wives ain't letting them out of the house and shit. We're in a pandemic. You're not going anywhere. You know, so just sitting here drinking by myself, but man, that hangover the next day. Oh my God. I'm so glad my birthday fell on a Monday. I took Monday and Tuesday off. And I'm so glad I took that Tuesday because I just laid in bed all day. Worthless. Just like, oh, this sucks so bad. I do not miss these hangovers. But, yeah,
if you can only take the one day off, you should always take the day after your birthday off. I see a lot of people take their birthday off, and then they go out and party, and then the next thing you know, they got to get up for work the next day. So, yeah, you got to take off that day after. Just work on your birthday. You're not five anymore. You can do things on your birthday.
But they frown on me drinking at work. So, you know, I had to take both days. You know, fuck it, I get paid for it.
You just got to do it. Bring your flask to work. You know, you actually, go to our merch store with the new Diablos and Podcastica flasks. So, you know, you can go check those out.
Yeah, they'd be a dead giveaway. They're like, oh, why is Ian happy? He must be drunk. You know, why isn't he being a dick? He must be drunk. But, it was rough. And I didn't drink last weekend, and I don't think I'm going to drink this weekend. But if we ever get any kind of sports back, get some, football, which I'll be happy if we get it, man. I can't wait for, you know, Sundays with the guys coming over, watching the game and getting drunk, you know. I'm going hungover on a Monday because everybody's hungover, so nobody can point fingers. Everybody's shit, you know. So, I mean, I tend to, like, you know, during football, I'm drinking the beer. You know, I'm not doing a vodka drunk on a Sunday. Because I know I at least got to make it into work. So the beer hangover isn't quite as bad as the vodka. Vodka fits in better with my healthier lifestyle that I've been trying to live with.
So while you're drinking, what do you do? Do you watch movies? Do you listen to music? Are you just watching Pornhub? What's your nightly duties on your birthday?
Usually, like if I'm drinking home alone, I'm usually rocking out. You know, or, you know, even if I'm listening to something that's not like rock or, you know, I'm usually listening to music. You know, if I'm watching a movie, I'm just sitting there watching the movie. But if I'm drinking, I'm like, I want to hear this fucking song. I want to hear this song in forever, which, you know, it depends. Like if I'm listening to a record, I'm going to listen to it all the way through, you know, because I'm lazy. I'm not going to get up, you know, but oh my God, you know, if I'm playing shit through, you know, my computer. Oh my God. Oh, I want to hear this song. And like, you know, a minute into that, oh my God, I got to hear this song now.
Bunch of half songs. Yeah.
Oh yeah. A bunch of just the tips, you know, just the tip of this song, just the tip of that song.
You know that Sammy Hagar, he actually ain't that bad. That's a pretty good song, you know?
Yeah. I wasn't drinking fucking, rubbing alcohol.
You turned your hand sanitizer up. You're like, ah, this is good shit.
That would be the next time I take off. Fuck my brain. When Sammy Hagar dies, I'm going to fucking, I might take the week off, man. and that will be like, you know, cheap vodka, bath salts, all kinds of shit, man. I will just go
Cabo Wabo.
Oh, yeah. I probably will. I'll drink it, and then I'll piss in it, and then I'll sell it to a Sammy Hagar fan. Hey, you want this Cabo? I didn't like it. It's a little warm.
You know, speaking of a hand sanitizer, I can tell this pandemic might almost be over. We went to Target today. They had hand sanitizer and toilet paper. So I think we're almost in the clear here, people.
Yeah. Yeah. For right now. That's what they want you to think.
Oh, shit. Damn.
But, I'm ready for, you know, shit to get back to normal. Of course, I want everybody to be, well, not everybody, but I want people I like to be safe.
Yeah.
You know, I can think of a whole lot of people like, take that mask off. You don't need it, you know, and run up a cough on them and shit.
Well, do you know who the only people that I want to stay safe are? Our henchmen.
Yes. Fucking A.
These people need to stay safe. Wear your mask. You know, bathe yourself in hand sanitizer because we need you. And we see numbers. We see these numbers, and this is a very, very small fraction of the people listening to these episodes. So we need some more henchmen. And after I read this list, I will tell you how to become a henchman. But our henchmen this week are Christopher Ellefson, Nate Atchison, Adam Cox, Keith Rockford, Joseph Staub, Mark Alden Taylor, Samuel Wetz, James West, and Anthony Bonet. Or Anthony.
And the Mooger Fooger.
Now, fuck that Mooger Fooger, man. He hasn't shared a shit.
Man, fucking Mooger Fooger.
Who is the Mooger Fooger? I don't even know who the Mooger Fooger is.
Yeah, so I met him at one of the Rockin' Pods, but, you know how drunk I get at Rockin' Pod. I probably met him two or three times. but was nothing like what I expected. You know, with a name like Mooger Fooger, I don't know what I expected.
Right.
You know, like a mountain man or like some crazy rocker, and I thought he was a cop. You know, this guy looked normal, clean cut. Like, I didn't do it. I'm not holding anything. But Mooger Fooger, God damn it, start sharing our shit, will you?
Yeah. We'll shout you out on each episode.
Yeah, yeah. But so let the Mooger Fooger know how he can become a henchman.
So, to become a henchman, Mooger Fooger, you head over to the Diablos and Podcastica Facebook page. Share from the official Facebook page. And it's as simple as that. You'll be read on the upcoming episode of the Diablos and Podcastica.
Yeah, you mugger fugger.
The God mugger fugger.
Shit. Well, thank you, henchman. Thank you, everybody who shared this. And, you know, I love hearing everybody's thoughts on the episodes. Everybody seems to be digging them. And I really appreciate all the help.
Nice. And
talk about other people who help us or people who leave iTunes reviews.
Gotta love them.
Gotta love them. All right. Well, we're going to read four more this week. And this one is a five-star review. This one comes from Hottie Lodge. I think is how you pronounce this. And it's entitled Great Rock Talk and Interviews. And he says, and I quote, "This show features two of the strongest voices in rock podcasts, Josh Toomey of Talk Toomey and Ian Wadzilla Wadley, formerly of Rock and Metal Combat Podcast. They're off to a strong start as they bring their unique perspectives to music, news, interviews, and album reviews. Humor, knowledge, and great stories. This is one podcast you don't want to miss. Subscribe and share." Yes, indeed. Thank you very much.
I love
very
it.
Very good review.
Strongest, right, two of the strongest voices in rock podcasting.
I think you mean strongest smelling, but you know, I'll take it. Okay.
Strongest aphrodisiac voices.
Strongest than all.
Nice. All right, so we got a five-star review from Tom B., New Jersey, titled, "Dang, This Is Good." Tom B. has to say, "I wasn't aware of their previous podcast history, so there's that. Then I heard their interview on the CMS podcast, so I gave it a shot. Two episodes in, and I'm hooked. Funny, solid analysis, and good chemistry. Subscribe, Edelheads. Now, do I get free stuff?" And actually, you did get free stuff. You just never gave us your address, so...
It was somebody else who won the other one,
Tom B in New Jersey. Yeah. He came in second, and then we ended up giving it to him, and he still hasn't come forward. There have been two people now that two people now have not come forward for that illustrious Brian Posehn free CD.
What was our third episode? We must have lost him there,
right?
He never came out. Come on, Tom B in Jersey. What exit? What exit? I love that though, because that's really awesome though. Somebody coming that didn't know our prior history,
yeah,
podcast world. So that means a lot. They all do, but I mean that's always neat when people just find you out of the blue. So come back, Tom B. All right. Well, I got another 5-star review. This one from Pimpin' Ho. 5-star review entitled "Breaking Down the Walls." He says, and I quote, "In a world where division and drama rules the day, two podcasting titans are on a mission to break down the barriers, not limited to any specific genre, to bring the listener music, news, pop culture critique, and any discussion they see fit to redefine the podcast medium. Sit back, pop a top, and buckle in. It's going to be a wild ride." Hell yeah.
That's what I'm talking about.
Good summary there. But podcasting titans? Shouldn't we be podcasting raiders?
I mean, titans are where the gods, where the Greek gods. You know, raiders are just people on ships. A bunch of pirates.
How many rings you guys got?
Oh, look at this. Another iTunes review. Oh, 5-star rating. From Chilled75. the last time the Raiders won a Super Bowl back in the 70s.
It was 83.
Shut up. This one is titled Back for the Attack. An essential listen for anyone who enjoys metal music and a good laugh. Ian motherfucking Wadley is a podcasting god whose verbal lashings could knock out even an Andy Kaufman or Roddy Piper, especially when he's well inebriated, which lucky for us is most of the time. This Toomey guy seems okay too. He has some big shoes to fill, but so far no complaints from me. I wish you all the best. In the immortal words of Ian's favorite drummer, don't forget to take it outside. Yowza. I believe I've read that one before because I didn't know how to say yowza.
Yeah, I love that one though. That is a great one. But one thing I correct there, and I might have said this the last time, you ain't got no shoes to fill, because this is something new, and I think we do great with what we got, and no reason to compare this to any, you know, either of our, well, your still current show or my previous show. We stand on our own two legs here, and damn lucky to have you there, Mr. Toomey.
Well, thank you, sir. And I did want to read one more, and if you can, to go to iTunes. If you don't have iTunes, which not all of us does, I don't listen on iTunes, but you can always head over to the Facebook page, go to the Diablo Sim Podcastica Facebook page, and leave a nice 5-star rating over there, as our good friend Jason Bakken. Bako from the Cobras and Fire podcast left us a nice 5-star review, and it says, I can speak from experience, both hosts are disappointing lovers. Toomey goes for it, but will eventually disappoint. While Ian only worries about himself, might as well marry him. 5 stars.
You know, I'm sorry. I don't like to get snowballed, you know? And I'm done. Go brush your teeth, and then we'll spoon.
Yeah, I mean, like Bako, I try, you know. It's just, I'm a Minuteman, so.
Shouldn't have fucked you so hard.
Right, exactly.
Horrible. Well, that's awesome. Yes, that is another way, because I've had people contact me like, hey, I don't do fucking iTunes. You know, well, go on the Facebook page and make sure you go there. Remember, there are the two different pages. There's the group and then the official page. The official page is where you want to leave your reviews and, you know, share the show from. The group you want to come to and talk shit about Toomey because he's not on the page. You can do it there and he won't see it. And, you know, I know I've been promising, but you know, a lot of shit going on in the world. I'm still working on our MySpace page too. And you know, once I get that up and running, you know, and people's dial up starts working again, you know, you can go there and leave something too.
Yeah. And if you leave a nice comment on our MySpace page, we will put you in our top 8. So.
All right. Well, thanks for those reviews. Keep them coming. I love reading that shit. And, well, fuck. We got any news this week? Is there anything going on besides coronavirus? It's the
news. There is a few things out there, though. I will start this week because, obviously, my favorite band is the top story. So we've got Philip Anselmo says it will be challenging to bring heavy metal concerts back during the coronavirus crisis. Do you think it's going to be challenging to bring back heavy metal concerts?
I think it's going to be challenging to bring it back. Period, and especially some of the shit that I'm hearing doesn't sound good. Talking about there'll be no more moshing, you know, no more getting in the pit.
But how many times have you been to a club and it says no moshing and there's moshing?
I don't know. I'm not a strong reader, but I don't know. I think it's going to depend on the club and the size of the venue. It's going to be weird. I've seen shit where they're talking about now everything's going to have seats and, you know, nobody's going to be sitting next to each other, you know? And the one thing I fucking hate, man, I hate a show with seats. I mean, I can deal with it if it's an arena show.
Right.
I get it, but I really hate club shows where there's seats.
Yeah. We've got an old theater here that they do shows at that has old, it's almost like old movie theater style seats. And, you know, yeah, it's kind of a pain in the ass when, Marilyn Manson comes through and you're like, why are we in seats?
You know? Yeah. Yeah, you know, and then you always got, you know, the people when their seats, like, they're happy, you know, because they want to sit down. And then they're always bitching because people are standing and so and so. And it just, it's not conducive to rock and roll. Even my favorite club in the whole world in Chicago, the Aragon Brawl Room. Sometimes they would have seats and sometimes they wouldn't. And I remember when I saw Faith No More there in the Angel Dust Tour, they had the chairs out. And when they would do that, they would stick like 2x4s in between the seats, you know, so you couldn't pull them up and shit.
Okay.
But Pat went up and, you know, launched into the song RV off of Angel Dust, which is perfect. He's like, somebody throw me a chair. And man, they just, you know, busted the 2x4s, chairs are flying. I was like, yeah, see what a great idea this shit was? You know, now it's more dangerous than if you didn't have this shit. And I think that was the last time I ever saw a show at the Brawl Room that had chairs. I think after that, they learned their lesson.
Right.
Okay. If long-haired people are going to be here, or skinheads, you know, let's do away with the fucking chairs.
Now, I was going to say, so that, you know, I did go out to a restaurant today and sat down and had a meal. My daughter graduated high school. She got to do a social distancing, I guess, walk, you know, to get the diploma. They herded four of us in, into the gym. You know, we were very far away. She walked across the stage, got handed her diploma, walked off stage, and then we were done. Like, it was very bizarre. Like, she almost didn't do it. She actually declined doing it at first. And then one of the teachers was just like, it's going to make me sad if you don't walk. So she ended up doing it. But so after the thing, her and I went to get some lunch, and we went over to the restaurant, sat down, and they had, you know, every other table was, you know, basically marked off where you couldn't sit there. And the waitress had a, you know, mask on, and it was nice to go and sit down at a restaurant for the first time in 3 months, but it was still just like kind of awkward. And we both got steaks and they gave us plasticware. And she made the best point of the whole thing. She's like, why can't they give us a knife? They're going to reuse this plate. You know?
Yeah. Now let me ask you this, during, you know, this pandemic, do they still throw peanuts on the floor at Bennigan's?
You know, no, they didn't have any peanuts. It was a Cheddar's, buddy. Get it right. We were classy today.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've heard this shit about the plastic silverware. I heard, you know, a lot of places are going to have to be, they're going to try to encourage you to order your meal before you get there.
Oh.
And order it online so they're not, you know, handing you menus back and forth.
Yeah.
Which I would be fine with that. You know, you could go online. Hey, probably less wait time, you know. But hopefully it's not a situation where, you know, your dinner's been sitting there for a fucking half hour, you know. That would suck. But I've seen all kinds of different things they're proposing. Like, they would have, you know, screens at your table, you know, where you hit the menu, what you want. That way they don't have to touch you and they can wipe it down after you're done. A disturbing thing that I've seen a lot of people talk about is restaurants not using their AC.
What?
Which I because there was this thing, you know, there's a case they proved somewhere in China where one guy infected like so many people because he went there, coughed or sneezed, and he was sitting right under the AC return, so it sucked that shit up and then shot it back out all over the whole restaurant. So they were talking about restaurants like having open windows or leaving the door open.
Yeah.
But
I have seen where they talk about where they can have more outdoor seating in a lot of like restaurants, like in a downtown situation, like they'll block off the roads if there's a few restaurants on the thing and you can actually basically put tables out into the road for the summertime, things like that. But it's just there's just so much weird information out there. I mean, in the last 2 days, I mean, they've said that it's highly unlikely to spread from surfaces, and then I think today they put out that it's, you know, asymptomatic people may not even be able to pass it. It's just like, so what? Where are we getting? We're basically getting to the point where if you have the flu, you stay home because you know, you're sick, you stay home. So now it's almost to the point where it's like, if you have the coronavirus, just stay home. You know, like I'm getting a little annoyed by this whole thing.
I don't know. It's like the whole thing with the restaurants. Like, I'm a cheap fuck anyway. So, like, I don't go out to eat a whole bunch, but when I do, especially like somewhere here in New Orleans.
Yeah.
You know, most of the time it's muggy as a motherfucker, man. And the last thing I want to do is be sitting outside getting ate up by fucking mosquitoes, sweat my ass off, you know, while I'm trying to, you know, while I'm eating an expensive dinner. You know, I want to be in the AC. Like, if I can't sit in the fucking AC, you know, especially in the summertime here, like, you know, tourists never hardly ever come to New Orleans during the summertime because it's just unbearable.
Right.
And we're not by the ocean. You know, there's no breeze. Like, you know, when I lived in Florida, it was hot, but I was living by the ocean, so you always had that ocean breeze. You ain't got that shit here. You know, I don't know how this shit's going to fucking work either. And, you know, it's weird. You see, like, some areas like Georgia, they say, you know, they've been pretty lax on their shit. And their numbers are going down. But other places who have eased up on restrictions, like Texas and I believe Alabama and Maryland, they're seeing a big spike, you know, going back up. So it's like, fuck. And now Trump just came out and said, you know, that they're not going to close down the country again if it gets worse.
Right. So,
now, is that really, you know, but, you know, everything out of that fucking asshole's mouth is a fucking lie. So hard to say what'll really happen, but it's one of those, you really can't make plans right now because everything changes from day to day, week to week.
Right.
So when it comes to concerts, but we talked about in the last episode, I'm on the fence on what to do with my Primus tickets. Like, do I say fuck it and get my money back, or do I just wait because I've got decent seats? Who knows when the hell this show could even happen? Everything's getting canceled now. Everything's been officially canceled except the tour. You know?
Right.
Motley Crue and Poison ain't giving up, even though Joan Jett came out today and said she wouldn't feel comfortable doing a stadium tour right now with what's going on. So
yeah, I think since last time we talked, the Deftones tour has been postponed until next year. Sure. Everything's postponed until next year. That's it.
Oh yeah. Ministry canceled their tour. That's, you know, we're looking for news here, and that's all everything is canceled. Here's something that's actually nice though. I don't know if you're a fan of this band at all, but I absolutely love them. Cheap Trick just completed work on a new album. They're using this downtime to say fuck it, we're gonna work on another album, and they're already done with it, and they've got a new record label. They're signed with BMG, so, but they're even waiting on when the album's going to get released, and that's something that I don't know if you've noticed, but I've noticed is delay in releases, which I think is kind of silly in this day and age, because so many people order their music online. To where I don't think this would affect it as much, you know. It's not like everybody's like, oh, I can't go buy the new album because Sam Goody's closed. you know,
damn you, Camelot.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a different world. I mean, as much as I love, you know, going to local record stores and stuff, I ain't gonna lie, 90% of the time I order my shit online. You know, it's just a hell of a lot cheaper.
You know, I think it's funny, and this is a total side step from what you're saying, but, you know, people that are like, I don't stream, I only like physical copies, I bet you 99% of those people go to used record stores and buy those physical copies, so technically the artist is still not making any money off of what you're doing.
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, I see what you're saying, but there are some people that still, no matter what, they just want physical product.
No, I know. But the same people are like, I don't like streaming because it doesn't support the artists.
Yeah. Well,
and since when did anybody care about supporting the artists? Like, when people were buying tapes and, you know, we were paying $10, $12, $15, $16 for a CD, and the artist was making like less than a dollar off of it, nobody was bitching back then.
Yeah, and if you really believe that wholeheartedly about, you know, your convictions about getting the money of the artist, then don't do this fucking Spotify shit. Go buy the whole fucking album. Don't just buy a song on iTunes. You buy that whole fucking album and give them your money.
Yeah.
I'm for supporting artists. And stuff,
me too.
You know, and I'm a merch buying motherfucker when I go to the shows, you know, and everybody, you know, who still goes to shows knows that's gone through the roof, but I still pay it. You know, I pay fucking ungodly amounts for a fucking what should be a $10 shirt, you know, and And a lot of times I'll buy a vinyl there, and I'll end up paying more for it, but I know more of it will go to the artist, so, you know, I'll do that. But, yeah, don't so, get all high and mighty.
So speaking of you going to shows, what did you think of that clip of Bobby Blitz talking about you in the pit?
Oh, I loved it, man. I loved it. And he was right, man. I was in the pit all fucking night. I was down there right in front fucking singing every song. And but it's cool, you know. I mean, he was such a nice guy. The whole band was great. Such a personable time, you know. You know, I knew, you know, sometimes you can tell somebody's just being nice to you, you know, because you just bought a ticket to their show. And sometimes you can tell when they're just being sincere. And all of those guys were so cool. When I told you, hey, bring up the Rock Cox and see if he laughs, I knew he would remember that, man. I mean, because we seriously had a good – the look on his face, man, was so funny. I mean, he even started just shaking his head, looking at me, laughing. He goes, what's this guy's name again? I'm like, Toomey. You know, like he practiced it when he did it. So I knew he remembered. But to hear him say that – and, you know, acknowledge he saw him, it made me feel great, man. That was an honor to talk to him. And it just, I can't wait till Overkill comes through again. So, you know, I can come up with new questions to ask him. Because I'm sure they would, you know, grant me another interview, man. Because they were really nice people.
Yeah, and the interview that I did with him and Mark Menge of with their BPMD side project, whatever you want to call it, project that they're doing. I mean, all they did the whole time was like bust each other's balls, and then I just kind of handed them more fodder to bust each other's balls with. So it ends up being like one of probably my favorite interviews I've ever done, just because of just how loose it was and just how, you know, goofy and silly they both were.
Well, I know we had the interview that I sent you. You know, we stopped it at one point when the interview was officially over. But there's a part in there when Dee Dee came back and he's like, fuck you, guy, you know, just joking around. It was, you know, it was hilarious. They were all really good people. And, you know, that what's fucked up, though, is that's really going to set the bar high.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like everybody now is like, you know, are you Bobby Blitz cool? Or you know, or are you just doing this because your manager made you do it?
Right.
You know? And you can definitely tell the difference, and you can tell when somebody's real. And those were some real motherfuckers. And who knows, might go down in history as the last like guy to interview him in person.
True. All right. Well, I got some more news for you. You ready?
Okay. Go ahead.
Sammy Hagar has told Rolling Stone in a new interview that he is very optimistic about the possibility of a reunion with his Van Halen bandmates. He, quote, I foresee it happening. I'm not trying to plant a seed like I know something is happening. I know nothing. But I just know what I know in my heart and my head, which is that it has to happen. Whether it's Sam and Dave or not, I don't know that either. But he says, if enough water goes under the bridge before we die, it'll happen. It has to. God is going to slap us both around if he has to.
Will this guy fucking die already? I mean, seriously. I mean, I really, like, it would be worth me getting coronavirus just to find this motherfucker, you know, pin him down and fuck him right in the fucking mouth and just shoot coronavirus, because I guess you can spread that now, you know, through your pee-pee, and just kill this motherfucker. Like, die already. Let this shit go. God damn, you already, you know, like, pretty much ruined their fucking legacy, kept them from being absolutely perfect. Just let it go. Go be happy with your fucking circle jerk, man. Oh, I hate this fucking asshole. Oh, I really hate him. The only thing I hate worse is his fans. His fans I hate even worse, you know? Because Sammy can't help that he's that fucking shitty. He's just trying to make a buck. It's the motherfuckers who spend a buck on him and say, oh, yeah, that's good. Fuck you. Fuck you. That's a coronavirus, man. Take these motherfuckers out, man. I saw there was another headline where he said something about he's prepared to go on tour before they get a vaccine for this shit, and I am all for it. I'm all, man, go on, go to every fucking state fair, you know, through Trump country, and don't wear masks, people, and just fucking cough on each other. And die
checking out some hog mamas.
Yeah, just fucking die already. So desperate, man. And that just, you know, get by on your own shit. You know, he always brags about what a successful solo artist he is. Well, why don't you go out there with your scary fucking talent and brag on that? You know, why don't you go and brag, hey, I don't need them. Look at me. I can't drive 55. That's what kids really want to hear. You know? Leave Van Halen alone. But he knows that's the only thing that gets him in fucking headlines anymore. Hey, I was in Van Halen. You know, it's like, you know, Matt Sorum. Hey, I was at Guns N' Roses. You know?
It's like John Corabi.
Yeah. Hey. John Corabi's got talent, at least.
No, that's a great album, but it's still funny. He can still bank on that one album, and every interview is going to get that pull quote.
Well, yeah. Have you ever heard The Scream? Yeah, I'd be holding on to that one too. But at least that's something you can be proud of, you know. And I think in his case is a little bit different too. I think he's kind of a victim of that's all anybody asks him about. Because really, I mean, who gives a shit about The Scream?
Right.
You know? Or, you know, Union or anything like that. That's what they're going to ask him about. You know? Sammy Hagar, hey, they could ask him about that scary solo career he had that was just as big as Van Halen, according to him. This fucking asshole. Man, I wasn't even going to bring that up, man. It got my blood boiling.
Oh, come on now. Meds. You don't think I'm not going to bring that one up?
Yeah.
Well, I did find this one really funny. The Death Angel drummer Will Carroll says that he strongly believes everyone's collective prayers and positive energy played a part in his recovery when he woke up from a 12-day coma after testing positive for the coronavirus. So I'll kind of skim through this, but I think it's one of the more insane things I've seen, but... After the New York Post published an article on Tuesday with the headline Death Angel Drummer Says He Met Satan During His Near-Death Coronavirus Coma, Carroll took to his Facebook page to say that he is not quite ready to embrace the God thing. To make things clear, I'm not some holy roller all of a sudden. I won't be attending church every Sunday, and I won't be quoting scripture. I still like and have an interest in evil music, movies, art, and literature, but this experience was quite frightening. To the point where I truly believe a higher power saved me. What that higher power is, I haven't quite figured out. And then he later says, I'm still going to listen to satanic metal. I still love Deicide and bands like that. As far as for my personal life and my experience of what I went through, I don't think Satan's quite as cool as I used to. That's one of the most insane stories I've ever read.
So, you know, that's proof that this gives you brain damage too. You know, but that's as unfortunate as that's not uncommon. You know, when people go through life changing shit, they grasp at stuff. I mean, you see that a lot when people find religion and shit like that. It's usually after a traumatic event.
Yeah,
and their brain trying to process shit. You know, and. That's what that shit is, man. It's snake oil. It's giving hope to the hopeless, you know. But, you know.
Well, I think it's funny. I saw, actually, when Little Richard just passed away, someone played his very last ever interview, and it was very, you know, God-based. And how, he kind of just turned his back on his entire life, basically, his entire lifestyle. I mean, he's a, you know, gay black man from the South, and...
He went back and forth his entire life because, you know, he was raised in the church, you know, but he knew he was a gay black man. And, you know, when he was young and in his 20s, he said, fuck it, and went with it. And then he, you know, career goes on hard times, you know, then he finds God again, funny enough, you know, and he went back and forth, I think, a couple times, but then, you know, at one point he just became all about Jesus and was that way till the day he died. It's sad. I really see it as like mental illness, you know. Like I see some people that are just so into this shit, and I just, part of me, as much as like I'm an asshole and make fun of people, I really feel bad for people who like, because I see it as mental illness.
Yeah,
like, you know, that's I don't know, if I offend you, forgive me, pray for me. You know,
but, thoughts and prayers, Ian. Thoughts and prayers.
Yeah, that'll fix everything up. But what pisses me off, everybody, you know, when shit goes good, thank God. Oh, thank God. I'd like to, you know, an athlete wins an award. I'd like to thank God. You know, so what's that mean? God hates the guy who lost,
right?
You know, you know, nobody gives God credit for all the bad shit that he could change, but the good shit, like, oh man, thanks, you know, fuck. Well, I want a job like that where anything good that happens is because of me. Anything bad that's happened, you know, thy will be done.
devil.
I work in mysterious ways, you know, and then when something actually comes true, or, you know, something goes your way, oh, it's all thanks to Ian. Yeah, I want that fucking job.
Well, I do that. Anytime I get a raise or anything at work, I'm like, thank you, Ian.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's a t-shirt. You know, we got to come up with something for that.
We definitely have to do something with the Hog Mamas and then the, and then thank Ian. I was behind a group of some Hog Mamas the other day, and they were some of the places I deliver mail. It's on like a very popular, if you're going kind of on a motorcycle ride, you know, with a bunch of your friends kind of thing, because it's along the Ohio River. But it's funny because you'll just see them on like Saturdays, just like groups of them just going by, Hog Mamas galore.
Yeah, it's quite a sight.
Yeah, it is.
I saw a thing, some shit going on in Corpus Christi, Texas. It's topless Jeep Week or some shit like that.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. It sounds a lot better than what it was.
Just people taking their tops off their Jeeps, yeah.
Yeah, that's what it is. They're driving down the beach with the top off, and they showed the people out there partying, and there wasn't any people there that you'd want to see, like if it was a nude beach. There is some large and in charge people partying their ass off.
Well, that's like anytime you see those nude colonies or nude beaches and stuff, it's never like, you know, tens. It's always threes.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. And me, you know, as a two.
you're flattening the curve, man.
Yeah, jerking off to threes. Well, I'm here. Might as well, you know.
Nice.
All right. Well, lighter news. Bruce Dickinson's wife's dead.
Estranged wife.
Yeah, estranged wife. And this, I don't know, from what I've read, maybe there's been an update on the story, but it's just being listed as a tragic accident, and which has led to speculation that she took her own life. Which is sad.
Yeah.
They split up a couple years ago. And just prior to that, he was crediting his wife, whom he had, I believe it was his second wife. I don't know if this is the wife that fucked Nikki Six. That might have been the first one. But I don't know if you're familiar with that story.
I am not.
But well, that's the song Tattooed Millionaire was written about Nikki Six. Like bitching about, you know, Motley Crue, you know, a bunch of assholes and shit.
Oh, nice.
But, yeah, apparently Motley Crue was on tour in Europe, and this chick knocked on Nikki Six's door and just came there and started fucking the shit out of him. And then she left, and then the next day he meets Bruce Dickinson, and he's like, hey, I'd like you to get my wife, and it was the chick.
And, nice. And so later, how is that Nikki's fault?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know, but, you know, he got mad at Nikki. But anyway, I don't know if that's this chick or if that was a chick before. But anyway, you know, he battled cancer a couple of years ago and beat it. Credited his wife with, you know, helping him through it. And then he dumped her for, like, a girl about 40 years younger than him.
Yeah, that was like the Italian fitness model or whatever, yeah.
Yeah, he's living with her. She's French or something. I think they're living in Paris.
French.
Some shit like that. But, yeah, it just says tragic accident. And, well, you know, you hate to say something like this if you don't know the facts, but it's kind of been alluded to, and she might have been, like, severely depressed over the breakup of the marriage. They were married, like, 30-something years with three kids, you know. And it makes it sound like she might have killed herself. Which, wow. So that sucks. You know, it got to make you feel like shit, too, you know. if that's what happened. But, you know, either way, you know, sorry for, you know, for his children and everything.
Yeah.
This could be karma for putting out all those bad Iron Maiden albums.
Yeah, well, get Blaze Bailey back in the band. Let's do this right.
Oh, okay. Well, it's not that bad, but definitely not good.
Right, right.
All right, you got another story?
I'll do this last one, and then we'll dive into our movie of the week. So Metallica's been doing the Metallica Mondays, and the latest Monday concert was from the 1983 concert in Chicago. Part of it's on Cliff Amal, which is, you know, we've all seen a million times, but they played the entire thing, and it was just so much fun to watch that band kind of just at that time, you know, the first big tour across America. Learning their, you know, just getting their feet wet and being a touring band, and I mean, Cliff did a version of Anesthesia, which was like he added so much to it. Like, it was, you know, Anesthesia is awesome to begin with if you're a bass player, if you just like Cliff, but he was playing it, but then adding in little noodly parts here and there, and I was just like, holy fuck, man, Cliff was awesome.
You like that old stuff?
Like old Metallica?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know if you're like, that's too old. I like 90s Metallica.
No, I guess I'm a first five records guy. I know a lot of people say four or three, but I like the Black Album.
But that is awesome. That's one thing I will say about Metallica. They do put a lot of cool shit out there for the fans.
Yeah.
Well, like if you join their fan club, you know, you get all kinds of fucking goodies and access to shit, and they do a lot of awesome shit like that, so I will tip my hat.
Yeah, man, I mean, they were one band that just seems like they've had a camera rolling forever. You know, they always have. And then if you get these, like, those box sets of the early albums, you know, kind of redone, you know, you get all the demos and stuff, and it's just crazy how much of that stuff they kept around to just put out stuff. Like the Justice, or the Master of Puppets outtake stuff of just James like plucking on his guitar. It's insane. Like just all the writing sessions and things like that.
Oh yeah, those are definitely worth it. If you're a Metallica fan, invest in those.
Or you can just invest in Spotify, because it's all those things are on Spotify too.
Those things are on Spotify too, like even all the bonus discs.
Yep.
Shit.
Yep.
Spotify. Why can't you get Mr. X like a normal person?
Right. So it's great. I wonder how much they're making off of some of those, like, you know, 1 minute Master of Puppet demos.
Even the word Spotify, all I picture is like, you know, like somebody's playlist that's got J-Lo mixed in with fucking, you know, that one Metallica song they like.
Well, in positive podcasting news, did you see Joe Rogan's deal that he just signed with Spotify? It's like roughly worth like supposedly $100 million.
That, and what so people can listen to his shit on Spotify?
I think by the end of the year, I think it's going to be, he's going to pull everything from YouTube, and you can only, it's going to be Spotify exclusive. Like you can only listen to Rogan on Spotify. And they're going to offer the video content. And from what I've been reading and what I've been noticing with Spotify is, I mean, they've been, you know, dipping their toe into podcasting and all that recently. And then I guess now is like the big splash with Rogan.
Well, I mean, he's got a pretty popular, I've never heard it, but I know it's pretty popular. Like him and Mark Maron, those are like, you know, two of the biggest.
Yeah.
I know there's ones even bigger, but you know, it's stuff that has no interest to me, but good for them, man. Good for them. I ain't gonna hate. No, they can sell it.
$100 million.
Now, have you heard his show?
Joe Rogan?
Yeah.
I think you're like the only person on the planet that's never heard Joe Rogan's podcast. But
is it like Jericho where it's commercials every fucking 5 minutes?
No, he does a nice, he knocks all of his commercials out in the first 10 minutes or so. So, you know, you You hit play, and if you want to skip the commercials, you skip them and get you know what I'm saying?
That's how you do it, man. If you're going to do it, that's how you do it. That's one thing I quit listening to fucking Eddie Trunk and very rarely listen to Jericho because I just can't stand it because I'm constantly fast-forwarding it. Just when it gets good,
yeah,
you know, and interesting, then it's the Garden Weasel, then it's DDP Yoga, you know, and I'm like, oh, man, shut the fuck up already. You know, and it's like, those people don't even need that fucking money. We need that money. You
know? Right.
And if we were fortunate enough to have advertisers like that, man, that's how I would do that shit. You know, put it in the beginning so everybody can fast forward over it. Don't do it in the fucking middle and fuck up the whole flow of the show.
Right, yes. Right.
But, yeah, good for you, Joe Rogan.
All right. You ready for our album of the week, which this week is a movie?
Album review.
Yeah. Now, this is one I didn't get this from Mr. X. I actually bought this.
Nice.
Because I was looking. Mr. X couldn't find it. And I was like, God damn it, I really want to see this shit. Now, did you purchase a digital copy or did you have the DVD?
Neither. I just rented it on Amazon. So.
Oh, okay. Okay. My question was, I didn't know if, there's a bunch of bonus content if you get the DVD.
Oh, nice.
Because I got a documentary a couple months ago, and I bought a digital copy, and I also ordered a DVD. Cause, you know, and I always hate that. Like it's 2020. Put it on fucking Blu-ray. Okay, you know that's like put it on DVD. Why don't you put it on Betamax? You know, you have the technology, the best quality. You know, put it on that. But anyway, I was disappointed when I got the physical DVD that there was absolutely no special features. So I should have just fucking stuck with the digital copy I had. But you know, this is something that I would hope would have a lot of bonus features. Like, did you ever see Get Thrashed?
No, I never saw that one.
Oh my God. Great fucking thrash documentary. But if you bought the disc, there was a bonus disc that was just as long, if not longer, than the actual movie that covered so many bands that weren't covered in the initial movie. And just really made it worth your money. And that's, I was curious to see if they offer that with this movie we're talking about, Murder in the Front Row, a documentary about the 80s Bay Area thrash metal scene.
Right, I just want to say one thing first. Posers must die!
We're out of our minds. We were kind of crazy.
We were just kids.
Kids run amok.
It was scary, and it was dark.
It's this outlet for angst.
I'm Alex Skolnick, born and raised in Berkeley, California.
Hey, I'm James Hetfield from Metallica.
This is the music you don't want your parents to hear. Gary
Holt. David Ellison, bassist for Megadeth.
I don't need to say my name. Everybody watching this knows who I am.
We're doing it for chicks and beer, and I didn't drink.
My name's Chuck Billy. Grew up Dublin, California.
And the pits were violent as hell.
Mark Osigeda from San Francisco Bay Area.
Phil Demmel from Dublin, California.
The volume, the craziness was epic.
Wow, we got to do more of this.
Rob Flynn, Oakland, California.
My name's Rick Hunolt. I play guitar for Exodus.
People have a passion for the metal. There's no distinction between the bands and the fans.
We called it the land of misfit toys.
People in our scene, we felt invincible.
It was about survival. It was like, ah!
Exodus had the destruction recipe.
If Exodus was playing, we were there.
That's Paul Bailoff.
Kurt came up with a name and we were just like, wow.
What was the question again?
My name is Lars Ulrich and I'm from Denmark.
Tom Araya, fucking Slayer. Singer and bass player for Slayer.
I got goosebumps talking about it right now. And my name is Paul Bostaff.
Larry Lalonde, El Sobrani, California.
Charlie Benante, and I'm from the Bronx, New York.
Dave Lombardo.
Southeast LA.
There was an aura of watching history happen.
Yeah, East Bay guys.
They played before us, and that was kind of a mistake.
I am Robert Trujillo. I'm from Santa Monica, California.
There goes that guy who was in Metallica. What's he up to?
Isn't as exciting as you thought it would be, was it?
Murder!
And yeah, since you said, you know, you asked me if I saw it, I was like, fuck. And I bought it. I bought a digital copy. but it had no special features.
So my initial takeaway of this movie is it's about the Bay Area thrash metal scene fans, because the big bands that come out of this scene, technically most of them didn't start in San Francisco. Like Metallica moved up there from LA, Slayer from LA, Megadeth LA, Anthrax New York. You know, you've got the mixture of Testaments and Violence and kind of the bands that were probably fans of those bands that came through. But it was almost like, obviously, Exodus played a huge part in this whole thing, which kind of sucks because they don't get as much credit today as they probably should for helping nurture that scene and get it so big for bands like Metallica to come and play and Slayer to come and play and Megadeth to come and play. But the thing is, it was almost more about the fans than the actual bands that came, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of see what you're saying. And first of all, I highly recommend this. I think it's fun and entertaining. I am going to have a lot of critiques about it, but I don't want, you know, as much as there's going to be things I'm going to say I wish was done differently, I don't want to distract from the fact that I think if you're a thrash fan, particularly of the Bay Area thrash, you're going to enjoy this. But to me, it focused far, far too much on Metallica. Too much Metallica shit, you know?
Yeah.
And I was surprised as it's starting out, you know, to see James in there, to see Kirk and Lars, who, you know, a lot of these smaller documentaries, you know, you might get one or two of them, and it's usually not a lot. And they were heavily in this, where, you know, I'm kind of wondering, you know, I'm looking at who produced this thing, you know, and I'm like, did Metallica produce this? Because I would say almost 80% of this shit is about Metallica.
Yeah.
You know, and the number two band being Exodus. But to me, I mean, it's more, I see what you're saying about the fans, but I think it's just more about the whole, the scene in general.
Right.
And how it started. But I was really hoping that it was going to cover different eras of the, you know, the Bay Area thrash scene, because, you know, you had that first wave, you know, with the Big Four and Exodus and stuff. But then, you know, coming out of the Bay, you had Testament, you had Death Angel, Forbidden, Heathen, you know, all kinds of other bands that I was really hoping were going to get, you know, more time, because I know all this Metallica shit, you know, and maybe it's because I'm a music nerd, and, you know, when I love a band, I try to find out as much shit as I can. But there wasn't too much that I didn't know. I mean, little personal stories here and there.
I can agree with that too. You know, yeah.
But it's like, you know, when I see something, I want something new. But maybe, you know, maybe that's just weird, you know, because probably most people don't know as much about music as I do, or, you know, they don't get into bands the way that I get into them.
Yeah.
And study them. You know, so if you came this like, oh yeah, I like that Metallica song on the radio, you might learn a lot, you know, and it might be mind blowing, but I was really hoping that they would have dug deeper into bands that I feel deserve more exposure. Like let more people know about Death Angel.
Oh yeah. You know? The bands that they covered were very surface level. Because, I mean, I've seen other, I don't know if they're documentaries or anything else, but, I mean, like, even the stuff that Bob Nalbandian does is very, like, he gets deep into these bands that you've never heard of, you know? Like, the bands that, you know, maybe pulled a crowd for a little while, like, he'll bring those guys up. And I know he's doing a San Francisco, whatever his, can't think of his series, but he did one on L.A., and now he's doing one on San Francisco. But
he's got a bunch, and they're all on Amazon.
Yeah.
And if you have, and they're all free too. If you have Amazon Prime, you can watch them for free.
Yeah, he's a guy that we need to have on too whenever the San Francisco one comes out. But his stuff. he'll bring up these bands that, you know, you've never heard of. But yeah, this one is very skimming the surface, a lot of Metallica talk, which is funny to me because I know, you know, they always kind of banter about being from San Francisco. But, I mean, they were a band for, what, you know, 9-10 months before they moved to San Francisco. And then by the, you know, in a year later, they're on Megaforce touring the country. And so even like the other bands in the documentary talk about, you know, Metallica was here, but then they left. You know, they weren't right. Like born and bred San Francisco. They went up there, basically used the crowd, got their chops up, got popular, got a following, got signed, and then went away. And I think that from my experience being in bands and being around a scene, I think that if a band had done that to my quote-unquote scene that I was a part of in the late 90s, early 2000s, I think I might feel the same way I do that some of those guys do about them. Like, oh, well, they're kind of from the scene, but they're not really from the scene, or almost some animosity towards them. And I heard an interview with Gary Holt recently. He was on Rob Flynn's podcast, and he was, you know, he doesn't talk about Metallica in like these, like how most people talk about Metallica, like, oh my God, Metallica came to our town and crushed it, you know. He was like, yeah, Exodus played with Metallica and we fucking blew him off the stage. You know, he still holds that kind of almost grudge towards them. And I saw that a lot in this documentary.
Well, yeah, and I think even Metallica will admit that in interviews, you know, that, you know, they learned a lot from Exodus. And when they saw Exodus, I mean, if you want to talk about the heart and soul of that, the Bay Area thrash, it is Exodus.
Oh yeah.
You know, it all starts with Exodus, but there's so much shit that, you know, like I said, was spawned out of that I really wanted to hear about that. I thought it was going to be a more well-rounded documentary than what it was. But like I said earlier, again, it's still really good.
Yeah.
You know, I would recommend it. I think, you know, especially if you like these bands. What I like about this is sometimes some of these like Bobo documentaries you get, you know, nothing against them, but they just don't have the funds. So a lot of times you can't even hear the music of the band they're talking about because they can't, you know, license and shit like that. You know, I've seen whole documentaries on fucking Amazon where they don't play one song by the band, 2-hour documentaries about
right.
They can't get the fucking rights to the music.
Oh, so yeah, those are the worst.
You hear it. Well, sometimes they're so good, like informative, they're very well done, but it just takes something away if you can't hear the fucking music.
Oh, yeah.
You know? But I can't begrudge somebody that's doesn't have the money to pay for all that shit. That's why I'm wondering, like, you know, with all the shit that's in this, like, did Metallica really pay for this shit? You know, because A, it's almost all about them, and B, like, there's just, how did they get all this music into this? You know, it just seems like in this day and age, like the likelihood of what the money this is going to make, would it justify what would have to be spent for the licensing for this music? You know?
Yeah. So I think it was written. I think it was based off a book written by a couple of the dudes that were in the documentary, the Herald or whatever. So, I mean, I'm assuming I would say that they just got the rights, you know, gratis or whatever you want to say.
Yeah, and all those guys that were in this are in Get Thrashed as well. You really need to check that one out. I really think you'd like it. But that one at least does what I like about how they did is each band has like a certain time limit where they talk about that band and they move on to the next band. Of course, the big four are the first ones they kind of they kind of take it by region, you know, but the big four get best treatment, but then they move on to all the bands. And then bonus disc I was telling you about goes even more deeper, like all over the world, thrash bands from all over the world. It's really, really good. And that's one I recommend that if you get it, buy the physical copy just for that, for the bonus disc. Because if you get just the, you know, the stream of it, I don't think you get all that stuff. But no, this is good. And I did enjoy it. I don't regret. I think I paid. I actually bought it. I didn't rent it. I bought a copy, a digital copy, and I think it was like $11. So it's definitely worth that. And yeah, that's what I got to say about Murder in the Front Row. Any other things you'd like to add about it, or any critiques?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've said my piece on it. I think it was a really well done documentary, and you know, they. if you want to go back and get a history lesson about the scene and stuff. But I once again, I don't think it was as much about the music as it was about the fandom and like the passion of the crowds there. You know, they talk about, you know, L.A. being, what, 4, 5, 6 hours away from San Francisco. They were just not even feeling thrash and the European stuff. But then you go up to San Francisco and like they're just all up there just loving all of it, man. And it's just it's a pretty cool documentary if you're to see the entire scene. I guess it doesn't, I feel like it's balanced between the bands and the fans, like if that makes sense.
Yeah. And hey, you get like 2 minutes of Larry LaLonde in it, so that
yeah,
made me happy.
Yeah, and it's funny, I don't even know if they really talk about him being in Primus. They're like, Larry LaLonde from Possessed. You're like, all
yeah,
right.
Yeah, I don't think they mentioned Primus once. They just talk about Possessed, which, I mean, is understandable for what they're talking about.
Right.
You know, but even the time they spent on Possessed is very limited. And that's a band I don't even like. I tried to get into them, just like, eh. But I would have liked to learn more about them, you know?
Oh yeah, when we went to see Mr. Bungle in San Francisco, that's who opened for him, was Possessed, like the current version of Possessed, and I was like, you know, this stuff is interesting, but you know, the more you look into them, the more like, oh, these guys have as much stake in the invention of death metal as, you know, as a band like Death does, you know. So it's, you know, the history was there. It's one of those things where you're like, oh, well, this is history, not as much as great songs, but you might get a history lesson out of the whole thing.
Right. I mean, shit, that's why I bought it, you know, because as I dug into the scene deeper, you know, I found out that, you know, what they were trailblazing for what they were doing, you know, and I mean, and I bought it and like, fuck Larry LaLonde, I got to hear this.
Right.
I was like, oh, boy.
You know, back when I actually bought, when I actually used to go to record stores and flip through dollar bins, I actually found a Blind Illusion album and I was like, hey, that's Les Claypool playing thrash metal. So.
Did you like it?
Yeah, I mean, back then, I was, you know, I liked a lot of things. If I would have found Judas Priest back then, I probably would have liked them too. So good.
But, yeah, so that's our topic this week, and you picked this one out and did a good job. Originally, we were going to do like a movies, just talk about different movies and stuff like that, and then you picked this one out, and I was like, wow, that's a good topic. You know, I'd still like to do, you know, some movies or TV shows in the future. But, you know, we got plenty of time. Nobody's going to any shows. We got plenty of time to record it.
Right.
Do further episodes. So what about something old, something new?
Something old, something new.
Well, I want to start with my something old this week. And actually, it came to me today when I was looking at my Facebook, and I follow Monty Connor on Facebook, and he was kind of breaking down all the old Deicide album covers, and he was I don't know if you follow him on Facebook at all, but he's really good about finding the original art of Chaos AD and Arise, and you know, just all these old albums that were, you know, staples of the Roadrunner catalog. But he was talking about some Deicide today, and I have to say, man, I went back and did a deep dive in Deicide today, so I'm gonna go. I'll go with their first album, the self-titled. Deicide album from, I believe, 1990. I'm pulling it up right now. Yes, 1990. Ooh, June 25th, 1990. So I would have just turned 11. But, man, what a classic album. 1992's Legion, also a great album. But yeah, man, the first album, Sacrificial Suicide, Lunatic of God's Creation, Dead by Dawn, the title track. When a band does a title track that's named after themselves, so you got the song Deicide by Deicide on the album Deicide. You can't go wrong. But classic death metal album, and I love it.
Awesome. All right. Well, my something old this week isn't a band or a movie, but it's a TV show. And actually, it's not even that old. Well, it's older than what I picked for my something new. So there's that. It's so new, you might even like it. But it was incredible show. I watched it when it aired, and I just started rewatching it now, binge watching it, and I'm liking it even more. And that is the show Banshee.
I do solemnly swear that I will faithfully perform the duties of Banshee County Sheriff, the office of which I now enter, and that I have no knowledge of any circumstance, past or present, that would disqualify me from the assignment of this office. So help me God. For each your own,
for every man a religion. I'm the sheriff.
That's right.
I'm Kai Proctor.
There's not a criminal enterprise around here that doesn't start or end in his pockets.
I am this town. I helped build it, and I bled for it. Have you ever loved anything like that?
I'll catch up to you.
How did you find me?
Who were you?
For 15 years.
You were the most notorious thief in the country, and you go into the one place you absolutely should not go.
You could have led Rabbit straight to me.
For years, I've been thinking, where is she?
This is not how I saw it playing out.
Leave here and forget about me.
If I don't,
I'll kill you myself.
They're afraid of me, because they should be. And maybe you should be too.
Find them both. You will suffer every single day you are in here.
You have no idea what he will or will not do!
This happened in your town, Sheriff Hood. This blood is on your hands.
We have to get out of Banshee right now.
Are you familiar with that?
No.
Cinemax.
I don't know what that one is at all.
Oh, man. It's just crazy action, sex, mystery. It's a really cool show about this guy who just got out of jail, and this guy who's going to be the new sheriff in town gets murdered before he even gets to take the job, and this ex-convict steals his identity and comes into town and says, hey, no, I'm this guy. And there's all kinds of intrigue and backstory, and Amish people and Indians, and it's wild. But I mean, the action's incredible. There's all kinds of sexy shit in there, and this is something I know my ex loved it, and my buddy, him and his wife, would watch it together, because you know it's got chicks in there for the dudes, and it's got dudes in there for the chicks. But the storytelling's top notch, the action, and plenty of fucking stroking it seems too.
Nice.
And it ran for 4 seasons. You can get it on you can get it on Blu-ray. If you buy the seasons on Blu-ray, they come with the digital copy, or you can go on streaming sites like Vudu. Like I'm getting it now. I've got the first 2 seasons I already had on Blu-ray and had the digital copy. Now they got the other 2 seasons. There's some, the seasons are like $5 for HD version of it. I'm like, fuck yeah. And I'm binging that and shit. That's what I'll be watching when we're done. But yeah, Banshee. Check it out. One thing I will say though, I know sometimes when somebody recommends some shit to me, I'll look it up and I'll do a little research on it. This is a show. I wouldn't recommend that, because there's all kinds of like shit that you don't want to find out. If I'm like one of those guys, I don't want spoilers. I don't want to know how the fucking movie ends before I see it. And there's a lot of cool twists and turns. So if I sold it enough to you, check out an episode, but don't go on like Wikipedia, because you're going to find out a bunch of shit that'll, end up spoiling it for you.
Nice.
Don't do that. That's my something old.
Well, I guess that helps me out with my something new, because I was kind of at a loss for something new here. But I will go with a miniseries that came out a couple of years ago, and Netflix just re-picked it up. but it's the Netflix series Waco.
You've looked to me to be your leader, to guide you on this journey. But I'm no leader. I'm a follower, just like you. God has instructed me to stay here and wait for his sign. This is our time to prove through suffering that we are worthy of the miracle that's to come. The kingdom of heaven is coming. I promise you.
And it kind of ties into my, not my latest episode of Talk To Me, but the one before it. But obviously about David Koresh and the tragedy that happened at Waco and everything that happened there. But it made me realize that it was written that Waco was based on a book called Waco, A Survivor Story by David Thibodeau, who was in Waco at the time. If you find out in the miniseries that he ends up being David Koresh's drummer. So I'm like, well, wait a minute, there's my in. So I found David Thibodeau on Facebook and talked to him a little bit about him coming on the show. And we talked all about the music that was made in the Mount Carmel complex there in Waco. And we, he talks about David Koresh being a huge fan of Steve Vai and Joe Satriani. Because every time I saw a picture of David Koresh, he's always got these crazy heavy metal guitars. And I'm like, man, he has got to be into something cool. And I reached out and we had about a 40-minute conversation all about music. Not just about, obviously the 51-day standoff and all that stuff. But man, the miniseries Waco, currently on Netflix, it had been trending for many, many days in a row. Very, very cool. Very cool documentary.
God, is that how long that went on? 51 days?
Yeah. I didn't realize it was that long either. Yeah.
Wow. Was there anybody in Waco like protesting? Like, I need a haircut. For 51 days. It's unconstitutional.
I'm not wearing no. Well, they ended up, they did end up wearing masks at the end, but.
Yeah, gas will do that to you. Make you put on a face mask. No, I would like to check that out because I saw a documentary that was done back in 97.
Yeah, I just watched that again the other day. So
I barely remember it, but I remember I enjoyed it. But God, it's so old. I remember I borrowed it from a coworker, and it was a double VHS.
Yeah, it's all on YouTube. It's 2 hours long. It's I can't even remember what it's called, but it's like it's pretty well done, and they have a lot of the footage. And the one thing I did notice from everything that I read about Waco and everything that was in the that documentary that you're talking about, they did seem to get it. I don't know if you want to call it right, but they did seem to have a lot of factual things right. Things that happened. It wasn't too.
I like that in a documentary.
Yeah. Well, it was a mini series, so it's like based on kind of, the whole, like The Dirt is a mini series, not a documentary, So.
So is the one Netflix, is it acted out?
Yes.
Not like,
yeah, it's like a 6-part mini series. It's not a docuseries. Oh, okay. It's very well done.
Well, I will check that out. Is it on Spotify?
No, it's on Netflix, or the Mr. X site. Yeah, I'm sure it's there too.
Mr. X can get that Netflix shit. Trust me. Love me some Tiger King.
Nice.
All right. Well, my something new is a band that I just discovered last fucking night, and I cannot stop listening to this album. And then I was so excited, like when I heard it, like, wow, this is so good. I wonder if these guys got anything else. And I went and did some research and found out, yeah, they had like fucking 4 other albums and a couple EPs and shit. And this is a trio out of New York called Geezer.
Keep going.
when I first saw the name, I was like, who in the fuck would name your band Geezer? You know, like, everybody's going to think Geezer Butler.
Right.
You know? It's like, shit. I mean, I know that the term Geezer's been around forever. But just in the metal community, you hear Geezer. It's like, you know, like, God, this is the worst name since fucking Fozzy. You know?
That is a bad name.
But, But I was struck by the description of it. You know, it said, like, you know, psychedelic doom, you know, groove rock. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's my kind of bag, you know, so I'll check it out. And it had an awesome fucking album cover. But I checked out their newest album. It's called Groovy. And actually, I believe it's not even out yet. I think I got some early access to it. But this trio from New York has been around since, I think their first album was released in 2013. But it's just really, really good. And I would recommend it to fans of, like, Monster Magnet and, you know, like, Queens of the Stone Age kind of thing. And I know there's a lot of people who are divided on Queens. You know, oh, I love Caius, but I hate Queens. It's too arty-farty. This is more on, like, the heavier side of Queens. So I think it's heavy enough for people who like metal. You know, it's got, you know, grungy enough guitars and everything and killer riffs. But it also does have that kind of psychedelic garage rock, you know, stoner rock vibe to it. And I really can't wait to check out the rest of their catalog, but I can't stop listening to this one. I mean, seriously, it's rare. Even if I find, you know, I get so much stuff and I listen to it, I'm like, oh, I like that track. I'm going to have to go back tomorrow. I'm going to have to remember that one and go listen to it again. And sometimes I remember, sometimes I don't. But this, I just couldn't get out of my head and blaring it all day. So Geezer is the name of the band. The album is called Groovy. I believe it's comes out legally on May 29th. But you can go on YouTube right now. I imagine this episode will be up before the 29th. You can go on YouTube and check out some songs. I posted one of their songs today on Because There's More Than Kiss, my video segment I do Monday through Friday on our Facebook group, and got a good response. But sometimes it's like the people who check it out dug it, but you can tell, like, it didn't get a lot of, you know, likes. You know, a lot of people, if they see something and they don't know it, you know, it's harder to get people to check out new shit. I wish that wasn't the case, but it is. But the people who do, you know, check out, 9 times out of 10 in my Because There's More Than Kiss, it usually is newer or underground band. Sometimes it's a classic band, but
right.
You know, some you might not have heard in a while, or you know, or, you know, but this is a band, and again, like I said, I thought they were brand new, but they're not. So there might be some people out there already know who they are, but I'd never heard of them. Have you ever heard of Geezer?
No, I've never heard of them either.
But you should.
Well, I will.
Okay. So check it out. That is my something new.
Nice. And before we end it, I did want to say shout out to my friends over at the Roach Coach podcast. I just recently did an episode with them. That's Coach with a K. We talked about Primer 55 second album, the new release, and kind of did a track by track thing like they do over there. A lot of fun. And so make sure you guys go and check that out, because I had a blast recording it. And then always just check out my own show, too. Bobby Blitz, Mark Mangi of BPMD this week. So, good times.
And I saw that the story for your show where you're talking about new release and shit. And I read it so fast, I misread it, and I got pissed off. I'm like, those assholes got back together, and Toomey's not on the fucking album. They got a new fucking album and no Toomey. I'm like, fuck these guys.
Yeah. Definitely won't be my something new.
Yeah, I was mad. How dare they?
Right.
How dare they? But yeah, everybody check out Talk To Me. Another great show, so I hear.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Never heard of it, but I'm sure it's good.
Yeah, you know, you've been on it a couple of times.
Oh, that was you? Oh, yeah, great shit. Great shit. Check out the episodes with me.
Yeah, those are great. Those are always fun. Was that one of my Gene Hoglan interviews, Pantera episode, I believe, and maybe something else.
Yeah, I see you listen to it too.
You know, before we end, I will say this. I was looking at some numbers the other day, and so I was kind of going through all the old episodes, and I was like, man, there's actually some really good guests on here. You know, I don't know if the episodes are good, but you know, the guest list alone, I was like, damn, I've got some pretty decent people on here. So good stuff.
Oh, hell yeah. And soon we'll get some new people on here too.
Absolutely. Well, that will do it for another episode of Diablo Sim Podcastica. Make sure you're heading over to the Facebook page, sharing from the Facebook page, so you can get a shout out on the next episode and become a henchman and do all of our dirty work and let all of your friends know about the show. And if you've enjoyed it and you've listened to it this far, it seems like you have enjoyed it, make sure you're heading over to your iTunes, leaving a nice 5-star rating, nice 5-star review, and that would be much appreciated.
Hell yeah. Till next time, brother.
Till next time. I've been Josh with Toomey.
I've been Wadzilla.
And we will talk to you soon.
Diablos in Podcastica with Toomey and Wadzilla.